with us tonight. We're going to go ahead and start. Sorry, we're like 1 minute late, so sorry about that. Let's go ahead and pray, and we're going to have a good time in the presence of the Lord tonight. Lord, we just thank you for your presence. We thank you, God, that we can enter your gates with thanksgiving and your courts with praise, and that's how we position ourselves tonight, with thankful hearts, with thanks on our mouth and praise on our lips. Lord, we give you glory, we give you honor, we love you, and we say, Holy Spirit, would you just come and have your way in our lives, in our hearts, in Jesus' name. Do what you want to, Lord, not just for us, God, but through us, Lord, so that we can go out and touch this city, touch this county, this state, Lord. Would you just move through us? Would your spirit just blow through this place, Lord, and blow out of these place, out of these walls, God, and you would just change hearts, Lord. Oh, we're calling on you, God, to turn hearts. Would you move, Jesus?
Would you move? Darkness runs away. Would you move? No one's turned away. 'Cause where you are, fear turns into praises. And where you are, no heart's left unchanged. Hey. So come, move, let justice roll on like a river. Let worship turn into
As we wait in your presence, Lord. Fill us up as we wait in your presence, Jesus. Well, because if bondage is going to be broken, you work through people. So fill us up with your presence, Jesus. God, that we could go out and you could change the world. Restricted by something that's covering our mouth, Lord, that we would still speak out in truth and in love. Oh God, that you would raise up an army of people that would walk in truth and in love, that would fight for justice, that would seek mercy for your people. God, that we would be the hands and the feet of Jesus. God, we need your empowering. Fill us with your presence as we wait. Fill us with your presence as we wait.
That we would be a pure and holy bride,
marked by the power and purpose in the blood of Jesus.
while you just close your eyes right where you are. Lord, just set our hearts so ablaze. Lord, in a world that's still largely so filled with darkness, let the blazing of your Spirit ignited on the inside of men and women of God, including those of us here tonight, those of us watching online even. Lord, that there would be a reignition and an explosiveness to the intensity of your Spirit in us. Lord, as again, this is harvest time and harvest season. Even though the darkness would be around, confusion around, some levels of despair around, Lord, you have commissioned us, not as victims, but as victors carrying the mighty name of Jesus, as victor and king. Oh, Lord, that we can, by our lives and by our words and by our hearts, point men and women to you, young people to you. Thank you, Lord, for revival igniting in this city and in this region and in this area, Lord, and across our state and our nation. God, expose what has been covered that needs exposure. Lord, those things that have been hidden heretofore, let them be exposed, things that need to be. Bring to light hidden works of darkness like your word says. But let the church rise up and just be the church. Lord, as we proclaim your goodness and your gospel, thank you, Lord, for cleansing, pure motives, all these things, Lord, properly align us, and that open door and all it represents be in the flow of your river and the beat of your heartbeat, that pulse, in the name of Jesus. Amen. Amen. If you're in agreement, would you say amen real purposely? Amen. Amen. Glory to the Lamb of God. We're so glad that you're here tonight, and I want to ask the ushers if you'll come on. If you brought your offering or worship to present as an act of worship, or your tithe to present, is that an understanding that that's really what it is? And here's an opportunity to give. You need an envelope for receipted giving. They'll give you one of those. Lord, we love you because we're declaring that all we have and all we are belongs to you. So even as we sow seed, it's really out of your supply that comes. Thank you, Lord, for provision. Thank you for increase. Thank you for jobs where that's needed. Thank you for promotions where those are needed. Thank you, Lord, for faithful witnesses on the job and off the job that you're creating, building us to be. In the name of Jesus, amen. Amen. Just a little hearing test. Could you hear the high frequencies? Okay, you passed. If you could hear that. If you can no longer hear at all, I'm sorry. We'll pray in the church. Before I ask our guest speaker to come, let me run back down here to Bishop Cornell. Let you greet us. Would you do that? Let me slip over here and he has ministered in this pulpit before, but I'm going to take the pulpit to him first. And if you feel like...
Praise God. I'm still around.
Yes.
The devil thought he had me, but I tell you what, when the Lord gets on the scene, things happen. And the Lord has touched my body. I'm getting around better than I have in a long time.
Hallelujah.
And I praise God for it. And I thank God for this church. I'm hearing about these souls getting saved and baptized. I tell you, it makes me happy. It makes me joyful. Because great, I tell you, we don't understand how deep be a soul being saved goes. When you consider eternity, a soul is saved for eternity. Oh, I can get to preaching on that a little bit, because that's a long time that we're going to get to enjoy this salvation.
Amen, amen. I appreciate you. I just got to hear from him because he's an encourager. Pastor Teresa, would you come? And we welcome this guest speaker, Dr. Teresa Lawson, come and share. I'm pretty sure that you just almost have to constrain yourself tonight, because God is doing some things already. Amen. Amen. And I just say, God continue that in us. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you for
Amen.
Being here tonight All with right. this word that you're about to bring us.
Make sure I'm on. Yes, yes. Whew, hallelujah. That's good. Don't you love it? I love it when the atmosphere is already charged and it just feels good, you know? Did you know you can do that in your own home?
That's it.
That we don't have to wait till we get here? I charge my house. I charge my room. And Dad's now got a prayer shed out at the farm. Y'all ever want to just come out and pray? We got a place. You can pray anywhere on the farm, but he's got a prayer shed now, and I tell you, it's got to where if I start walking down that road, heading to that prayer shed, I start crying and begin to pray. And so you create your atmosphere wherever you are. Amen. Well, how many of you are about as old as I am, and you remember testimony service? Oh, good. There's still some Pentecostals among us. When I was growing up, we had what was called testimony service. And folks would get up and they would testify to the goodness of God and just the good things that God had done in their life and the provision that God had given to them. And I used to love testimony service. And I remember one sister, I think her name was Schism or Schism or something like that. It doesn't matter, Vince says. Huh? Schism. Schism. And she... And she sat on the second row back, and I don't know how old she was. She was old. But every time she'd get up and testify, and these are kind of things that stick with you as a kid. And so she would get up and she'd testify, and well, she would get to going about going to heaven, and just, you know, just couldn't wait to see her Jesus, and then she'd start doing this. You know, just... And she stood about 4 foot nothing, you know. But she'd start testifying. And so I grew up on testimonies. And how many of you know that your life is a testimony, whether good or bad? And the good and the bad both make your life's testimony. Back in 2011, I lost one of the most dearest people to me in my life, and that was my grandma. Grandma was the matriarch of our family, and Grandma was a prayer warrior. And if you ever wanted an answer to prayer, you called on the general. And when the general prayed, you knew God heard. And I remember being in Haiti, and boy, we were going through some warfare. How many of you know what the religion is over in Haiti? We were going through it, and I finally was able to get a hold of Vance through an email, and I just sent the word, and I said, call the general. We need prayer. He knew what I meant, and he called Grandma to pray. And years later, after we were going through her stuff, I saw where she had written down her prayer for me, you know, at that time. Well, Grandma died in, I think it was October 29, 2011, and boy, that was a hard season, you know. Just one of those things you don't ever want to get that phone call, but I'll never forget my aunts and I wanted to make sure that her celebration, she was dressed for it. And so we went back and we were doing Grandma's hair and, you know, doing her nails and making sure that she looked good for the viewing. And as we walked in, we're all walking in thinking, oh, I don't want to do this, you know. But we walk in and we start taking care of Grandma. And you just couldn't help it as we began to care for her and make her look good. We began to think back on her testimony, on her life, and the miracles that she had seen in her life. And so we began to share, you know, just things that Grandma had lived through. She saw a baby boy that had died raised to life. She saw cancer gone, that her cancer of the throat gone. And she saw a son that we thought was dead, but that God kept him alive. She had a son that had cancer, was given a 15% chance of survival. She yielded him to God and said, I'll take your will, but if it's not his will, your will that he die, I want him to live. And he lived. And I'm telling you, just miracle after miracle, we began to recount as we're in that funeral home getting grandma ready. And it made me think, you know, the times that we live in right now, you can get some pretty disheartening news, particularly if you turn on the news. And if you listen, everybody gets together and everybody wants to talk about what's going wrong and all the negativity. And if you're not careful, you just start finding yourself getting just kind of yuck. You know, and so what I wanted to do tonight was talk to you about something that would encourage you. In Hebrews 10:26, I can't remember if it was NET or which version I was looking at, but he said you spur each other on in your faith and in your works. And so tonight, I want to do a good old Texas kick, and I want to spur you on tonight in your faith, if you will. Hebrews 11:1 said, y'all know it. You don't even have to look at it, but you know it. Now, faith is the substance of things hoped for and the evidence of things not seen. Say that, not seen. Got it? Not seen. For by it, faith, the elders obtained a good report. Well, you know me, I like to break down words and what do they mean. And so I began to break down just that one little passage there. The definition of faith is actually Greek because it was in the New Testament. So the original is the Greek. And it was pistis, and it is the kind of belief that leads to a personal conviction that is firm. You are persuaded. You are fully trusting. You are fully committed. So you say that now this personal conviction, this personal persuasion, this personal commitment, and then substance of things. So this faith, this personal conviction, this commitment is a substance, which is a hypostasis, which is an underlying state. It's like the essence of. Can I tell you that we should have the essence of that faith, that absolute confidence in God? And then, the hypostasis meant the substance, the essence of, was like a Roman legal document, which we would probably relate it to a portfolio that tells you, you know, the jobs you've had, the papers you've written, the community service, it tells you everything about you. But it's kind of like it has everything in there about that person. Wouldn't it be wonderful that when your time came and they're preparing your body, they couldn't help but begin to rehearse the good things of the Lord? Or when someone mentions your name, you know, say, oh, you know that Linda, or you know the Shauna, you know Solomon. When they mention their name, you say, boy, they're a man or a woman of faith. And they'll say, did you hear that story? And they begin to recount your story, because your very essence is one of faith and confidence. And then that hope is an elpis, meaning Greek meaning that is to anticipate with pleasure. Favorable and confident expectation. I wonder how many of us, when we're praying for something, have that. I don't know about you, but mine most of the time looks like this. Lord, I'm hoping you're hearing, and I'm trying to have faith. But I want to have an absolute confidence and a hope. You know, the Bible tells us that we are to live by faith. If you're a Christian, if you're a righteous one, you are to live by faith. And then faith comes by hearing, y'all know these, and hearing by the word of God. In Jude, in verse 20, I like this, he says, now build yourself up on your most holy faith, praying in the Holy Ghost. Man, that just gave you two tools right there to walk and have that testimony of faith. And that is that you get the word and you begin to declare that word. If you don't know it by heart, if you haven't memorized it, then get you some note cards and you just begin to declare the word over the situation. Whatever the situation is, God's got a promise for it. God's got a word for it. Declare that. And then how many of you know that you don't know how to pray as you ought? Romans 8:26. And so there's often times that I just got to pray in the spirit with groanings that cannot even be uttered. And so as I'm beginning to ask the Lord, I know I need whatever it is the situation is, whether it's a healing for somebody or a deliverance for something, and I don't know exactly what to say. And so I'll ask the Holy Spirit just to begin to pray through me. So you get those two power tools in your belt, and you've got Word, and you've got the Holy Ghost. And I tell you what, the devil's going to run when he sees that arsenal coming after him. And so we need to be a church that's got our tool belt full of the Word of God and got our mouth full of the praises of God and worshiping God in the Holy Spirit. Amen? Amen. You know, you've all got faith. How many of you right now, don't raise your hand, pastor's here, but how many of you would think that you don't have a lot of faith right now? It just seems like, man, I'm struggling in that area. You know, it makes me think about up on this stage. I know we've got electricity running behind these walls. There's current that's going to the outlets here. You don't know that right now. Do you see that electricity? Do you feel that electricity? Do you hear that electricity? Can you smell it? Can you taste it? No, none of those things. How do I know? Well, one way is I put my finger in that socket. I'd know that there's electricity. Now, I'm not going to do that, but there's another way to know. When Solomon, if you were to come up and pick up your guitar and begin to strum, play it, then you would know that there's electricity, that he's plugged into electricity. So you've got faith, but you don't, you know, sometimes you don't feel like you do. You know what I mean? But it's there. Amen. All right. So, and I want you to know this too, that when you've asked God for something, don't check in with your five senses to see about the answer, you know? I don't know about you guys, but I got a bad problem about going to the Lord, first of all, with what I want him to do, and second of all, with how I want him to do it. And he's let me know many times throughout my life that, first of all, he doesn't need my opinion. And second of all, he knows exactly what he's doing. I've got this. Thank you very much. And so I don't need to go to him and say, Lord, so-and-so is sick, and tell him what he needs to do. I just want to bring him before the Lord, and I want to say, God, you're the God of all flesh, and he's going to live, and he's not going to die, and he's going to declare the works of the Lord. And Lord, I thank you that you brought your word, and you brought healing when you brought that word. And I just begin to declare his word over that situation, and I just leave my five senses checked out at the door, because faith is not based on rational intellect, rational knowledge, or your judgment, or what you think it should be. It's based on what he says. And I'm going to tell you, most of the time, it's not going to make sense at all to your mind how God does it. How many of you, God has just blown your mind with the answers that he gave? I mean, blown your, wow. We got to pray. These people need to have a blown mind. Y'all, there are times when you pray for something and God does it. I've been a Christian a long time. I was starting to tell you some years. A long time. And I still to this day, God will do something in a way I'm just like, you know, and so now all I do is like, that's just so like God. He blows my mind all the time. Hallelujah. I'm glad faith transcends rationalism. Hallelujah. But one thing I do know, God can't stand, I'm going to use the word that Asher says, Nana, we're not supposed to use that word, but God hates unbelief. And that's how strong he feels about it. He cannot stand unbelief. Without faith, it is impossible to please God. Wow, you can't get any more than that. You know, when I think it's funny that we call ourselves Christians or followers of Christ, and you know, thinking about Thomas. And when we think about Thomas, we talk about him, what do we kind of give him the nickname of? doubting Thomas, you know. But did you guys know that in John 11, when Jesus was going to go to raise Lazarus from the dead, I mean, that's a big deal. But he knew that when he was going to Jerusalem, there's a possibility he could be killed. And Thomas wasn't the one that says, not me, you go right ahead. I don't feel like dying today. But instead, Thomas said, come on, guys. He's going to die. We're going to die with him. And so, you know, it wasn't like he was this weak man. He was a Christ follower. But then you get to John 14, and him and Jesus is it's the discussion that Jesus is giving to him, and he's telling them, you know, says, and I'm going away, but you guys know the way to the place where I'm going. And Thomas looks at him and says, how do we know the way where you're going? And Jesus looks at him and says, now, Thomas, I am the way. I am the way. You know the way because I am the way. Well, so then we get to after the crucifixion. So you'd think Thomas would have learned, but we get to the crucifixion, and Thomas doesn't believe that it's the Messiah that's risen from the dead. He's not even going to believe it unless he puts his own hands in the nail prints of his hands and puts his hand in the side. So what does Jesus do? He slaps him upside the head a couple of times and tells him what an idiot he is. He doesn't do that. He says, Thomas, take your fingers, put it in my hand. Now take your hand, put it in my side. And as soon as he did, what did Thomas say? There were scars there. I just want you to make a note of that. But we have scars. And there were scars. He put his hands into the side and his fingers into the scars in his hand. And when he did, he says, oh, my Lord and my God. And then Jesus looks at him because he got a revelation. Jesus looks at him and he says, so now you believe because you've seen. How many times we've walked with Jesus, we've seen him do miracles, and then we doubt. We doubt when it gets to a critical juncture. We doubt that he can do it. We doubt that he's still the Messiah. My goodness. I want to learn from these folks like this, and I want to believe him on this side of that. Amen. Amen. So in Matthew 13, 58, Jesus went to his hometown, and they all thought they knew him, and he could not do many mighty miracles in that town because of their unbelief. Wouldn't it be awful if Jesus wanted to come into this place and do miracles, but we wouldn't let him because of our unbelief? Or because of, let's just say he wanted to use a donkey, or he wanted to use a rooster, I don't care what, or me. And because you're looking at the source, you're thinking, God can't use them. And so they were looking at Jesus thinking, we know him. His dad's Joseph the carpenter. And so they, because of the doubt and the unbelief, they didn't see the mighty miracles and the works of God that they could have seen. And then in Hebrews 3 and 19, says that the children of Israel were not able to enter into the rest, that peace, because they did not believe. They had doubt. And Mark 6 and 6, he marveled because of their unbelief. It's because he knows who he is. And he wants you to get that revelation of who he is. I want you to get that revelation. I want more of a revelation of who he is. You know, today I was walking back from the prayer shed and I said, Lord, I haven't seen a miracle lately. And I've seen a lot of miracles. But I haven't seen a miracle lately in one of those. And I said, Jesus, I love you. I believe you. And I want more of a revelation of who he is. And I don't care how long you've been a Christian or how much you think you know, you want more of a revelation of who he is. 1 John 5 and 10, this is powerful, guys. He said, those who don't believe are actually calling God a liar. Ouch. Stick your rationalism on that verse. Woo. Also, he warns us. Remember when I told you a while ago that sometimes I'll go to the Lord and I'll tell him how I think he should do something or what he should do? Sometimes we go to the Lord and we ask him for things that we shouldn't be asking for. It's presumptuous prayers. And that's found in James 4 and 3. It says, when you pray, your prayers aren't answered because you ask for selfish reasons, to just for your own human desires. But you know, the good news is even if we're unfaithful, Romans 3 and 3, God is faithful. irregardless, God is faithful. And here's the promises I want to read to you. Hebrews 11:2, it was through their faith that the people in days of old earned a good reputation, or the way I want to put it is they had a good testimony. I want us as Church of the Open Door to have a good testimony that they believed God. Amen. John 14:12-14, I want you to listen to this. Listen really carefully. We are confident that He hears us. When you pray, if you're a child of God, when you pray, He hears you. He hears you. He hears you. He hears you. And then whenever we ask for anything that pleases Him, and since we know that He hears us, when we make our request, we also know that He will give us what we ask for. Wow. Man, in the human mind, that doesn't even seem to make sense. But in Matthew 17:20, and if you're thinking, well, you've got to have this, you know, like great faith. 17:20, it says, if you have faith as a grain of a mustard seed, that is, it's not even, it's smaller than my pinky finger, the smallest thing, but it grows to be the biggest tree. Just the smallest amount of faith, and God says, I can use that. I can use that. 2 Corinthians 5:7, we walk by faith, and we don't walk by sight. Amen. Now, there's a supernatural gift of faith. We find this over in 1 Corinthians 12. Sometimes these are specific manifestations of a supernatural faith that's given by the Holy Spirit for a specific purpose. It's when God says you are to do this. It is for that purpose. And this is the in 12:1 where it says, you know, the different gifts. And then He says that there is then is given the gift of faith. And you see, it's through this gift of faith that God will reveal, and He gives power to believe in the face of impossible situations. And it is a supernatural faith that enables us as Christians to believe God for extraordinary, miraculous. There are times when we need just that gift of faith. This is a sobering story, but it's one that I can recount about when I was just given a supernatural gift of faith in an impossible situation. Many of you know my granddaughter, Aubrielle, and that she was to be aborted. And God intervened and spared her life. And you know, thank God for that. And so then my daughter raised her as a single parent. The dad, her biological dad, was the one that was really pushing for her to be aborted, and to the point where he even called me and was threatening me, and you know, and saying that's what needed to happen. And then we never heard anything from him till she was about 7 or 8 years old. And then he decides that he wants to sue my daughter for full custody of her. And at first, we did just like you did, Audrey. We laughed. We thought, there is absolutely no way. This is ridiculous. The courts will not hear this. We hired the best lawyer that Nashville had to offer. And we thought, not getting our girl. And so, but I remember there was about a month there of pretty arduous, intense court hearings, and I remember I was in Lowe's one day, and my lawyer called me, and he said, Theresa, the courts are really leaning towards paternity custody, and it's looking like that we're going to lose this case, and that he will be able to get custody of her. And I said, there's no way, Robert. You've got to find a way through this. It's impossible. Do you? And I began to recount, you know, his story again. And he said, Theresa, no, I'm not saying it's fair. I'm not saying it's right. I'm just telling you, this is the way it is. So this was a top-notch lawyer that knew his stuff that was telling me that we were facing an impossible situation, that this little baby girl was going to be taken from us. Now, I don't know about you, but when the devil comes knocking on my door, I don't let him in. And so I thought, well, we'll just see what God has to say about this.
And so I go home and I begin to fast and pray. And I'm telling you, there's an angst in here, you know, and you're just like, oh God, I can't stand to see this happen. And I prayed and I prayed and I prayed. And it got, and I would go to the Word, and I'm telling you what, I ate this Word. I'm telling you, it was in my face. I was continually, Lord, this is what your Word says. You know, and then I'd read something else. I said, this is what your Word says. And then I would begin to pray. And I remember one morning I was just devouring the Word again. And we knew that we had court coming up again where we was going to lose this baby girl. And just as clear as I can hear your voice, the Lord told me, he said, this day, you're going to step on the heels of your enemy. When God told me that, I didn't have anything to base that on. I couldn't see anything. I hadn't heard anything, but I heard from God. And God said, this day, you're going to step on the heels. You're going to step on the head of your enemy. I got up from that chair while I was praying. I got dressed for work. I went to work. And I, all morning long, as I was seeing patients, I was thinking, this day, I'm going to stand on the heads of my enemy. Got to lunchtime, didn't hear a thing, no phone calls. I went to the bathroom and I said, God, just want to remind you that you told me this morning that I'm going to step on the heels of my enemy. And so I go back out that afternoon and I saw patients all afternoon. Didn't get a phone call, didn't hear nothing. I go back home, I went straight upstairs to my office and I said, God, I just want to remind you that you told me that today I'm going to step on the head of my enemy. About that time I get a phone call. My lawyer says, threesome. He said, if you'll show up tomorrow morning, you and Vance, and you'll sign custody of that little girl, said she's yours, and he'll drop all charges. I said, what time you want me there? And I tell you, I got off that phone, and I began to do a dance on the head of my enemy. Hey! I said, you know what? You can threaten, but let me see what God has to say about that. And I did me a little dance around that room, dancing on the head of my enemy. That is supernatural faith. There was nothing inside this old girl that had that kind of faith. It was a supernatural faith that I grabbed out of 1 Corinthians 12, and I said, I need that faith. I'm going to hang on to that one because all circumstances are pointing to the opposite. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hebrews 11:1, he said that we understand that the entire universe was made by God. I want you to get that. I want you to get that. There is nothing made that he didn't make. You didn't make it. I didn't make it. The scientists didn't make it. Our God created. Whatever you're asking God for, if you need a creative miracle, may I tell you that Elohim is still alive and well. Elohim, the creator of all creation, is waiting to do a creation for you. So by God, all that was created. And then it was by faith that Abel offered up a more excellent sacrifice. Now, why was Abel's sacrifice more excellent than that of Cain? Was it because his was a lamb and Cain's was grain? No, it was this heart. It was this heart issue. Don't go before the Lord doing just, you know, the perfunctory, the what we know to do. Okay, I know I need to pray like this. I know I need to say these words. And I know that, and if I fast this many days, it's almost like we're going before the Lord, but we're not going before him in a worship, you know, putting him on the throne where he deserves to be. And so when Abel went before him, it wasn't that he was just doing an obeisance and, you know, being obedient. He was actually worshiping him. And because of that, his sacrifice was accepted. And then it was by faith that Enoch was taken up to heaven. I think about this. Y'all heard my dad, and so I was blessed to have a godly heritage. But I think about saints like that, you know, the older saints, and not that mom and dad, y'all are old or nothing, but I think about, you know, saints like that and how they walked with God, and all they ever talk about is heaven and Jesus and going home, and, you know, and so every once in a while, I just wouldn't be surprised if they were just walking along and all of a sudden just stepped on over into that glory land, you know, just walked on over. Well, Enoch was doing that. He was walking with God. His testimony was he walked with God. Wow. He walked with God. He didn't leave him at the corner when he went to work. He didn't leave him in the car when he went into Walmart. He walked with God. He had that testimony. He walked with God. And because he walked with God, the Lord said, you know what, Enoch, won't you just come on home with me today? So that day, Enoch just stepped on over and walked on into the glory. And it was by faith that Noah built a boat to save his family from the flood. He obeyed God. Because, see, God warned him about things that had never happened before. And by his faith, Noah condemned the rest of the world, and he received the righteousness that comes by faith. Can I tell you that sometimes God may tell you something, or you know that you're to pray for a certain situation, but in the rational mind, you know, the five senses, it doesn't make sense. And you tell people your vision, your dream, what you're praying for, and they ridicule, they mock you. Now, you can give up on that, and you can say, you know, they're right. That doesn't make sense. It doesn't, according to the, you know, everything that we can see, feel, or hear, we look at all the circumstances, circumstantial evidence to see if God can do it. God don't need that. It had never rained. It used to have a mist that came up, and that's what watered everything. They didn't know what rain looked like. And this nut was telling them that it was going to rain. Not only was it going to rain, but it was going to flood. And if they didn't get in the boat, they were going to die. They called him crazy. Well, they died. But by faith, in spite of the ridicule, in spite of, can I tell you that sometimes you may go against the grain, you may go against the norm, and because nobody else believes it. He was the only one that believed that. God told him that, and he stood on that. Sometimes, because you've never seen it done that way before, you think God is obligated to do it the way you've seen it before. James Lynn, my brother, was telling me a story about he was a poor college kid, and he was living with us at the time in Burleson, and he was evangelizing on the side, and he had come home one evening, and he was on empty. But he didn't want to tell us, didn't want to ask us for gas money or anything. And so he gets up the next morning, and he's praying all the way there. And he just thought for sure someone was going to put some money on his windshield, because that had happened before. He went to church. Oh, wait, that night when he came home, we went to church, and he thought someone was going to give him money because they had done that before. Nobody gave him money. Nobody put money on his windshield. So he drove to college. And still, he said, I was on fumes by that time. Well, then I was going to come back home. And he was like, Lord, because the Lord told him that he was going to fill his tank with gas. And James had nothing, not even a penny. But the Lord told him, I'm going to fill your tank with gas. And he knew he wasn't supposed to ask anybody. And so he leaves Sagu, and he's on his way back. And he runs out of gas in Midlothian. And so, you know, in your flesh, you're like, well, now what you going to do? You know, because, Lord, you told me you're going to fill my tank with gas, and here I am. I'm out of gas, and this tank is empty. So he happened to be by a gas station, and so he rolled it on in. And so he goes inside the gas station, and he asked if he could use the phone. And back then, this is before everybody had cell phones on their hip. And he was calling me, and I didn't answer. And he called Vance, and he didn't answer. And so he went back out to his car, and he sat down, and he thought, what am I going to do? What am I going to do? And the Lord kept saying, though, every time, even before he went in to call me, the Lord told him, he said, just go ask that guy the attendant give you gas. He said, no. You know, and so then he called me. I didn't answer. We went back out to the car. The Lord said, go ask him for gas. James said, no. And so called Vance. He didn't answer. So finally, the third trip back in, you know, the Lord had said again, ask him for gas. And James is like, no. And so, because, you know, it had never, you're not, when God says he's going to fill it with gas, I guess James was thinking God was going to supernaturally get a siphon hose and, you know, I don't know. But But anyway, so James goes in. The guy said, "Can I ask you what's wrong?" And James said, "I ran out of gas, and I don't have any money." And the guy said, "Is that all?" He said, "Here, I'll help you." And he pulled it up, and he said, "I'm going to fill it up for you." James said, "Well, you don't understand. I'm a poor college kid, and I don't even know when I'm going to get the money." And the guy said, "Don't worry about it. This one's on me. Full tank of gas." James said, "That car had not had a full tank of gas in months, but it had a full tank of gas." But you notice that he even had to run out of gas, you know? And so when you're believing God, this is for somebody. You're believing God for something, and it's impossible. It seems impossible. You're believing God for it. You've done everything He said to do. You've gone by faith. "Well, I've done this. And Lord, I'm doing everything You've said to do." And then you run out of gas. And you're thinking, "Now what you gonna do, God?" But can I tell you, God don't need me or Vance. He doesn't need a supernatural hose, gas hose from heaven. If God wants something done, it's done. It's done. It's done. So don't lose faith. Don't lose faith in the midst of when you're going through this process. I want to tell you about Abraham, too. Y'all all know these guys. What am I doing? I'm trying to stir up your most holy faith. Yeah. Abraham, I like his story. How many of y'all read Genesis? Good. It's the first book in the Bible. It's the book of origins. And it's really good because it's like a storybook. But the story of Abraham is one that I really like. Because, see, Abraham was given a promise way back in Genesis 12. He was going to have a son. Now, at this time, it looked impossible for him and Sarah to have a child. Things weren't working. And so it seemed like, well, okay, God, this is going to be a you thing. He believed God for it. Well, then we move over to chapter 17, and once again, he's sitting. Here's what I like. So Abraham is sitting in his tent door underneath the terebinth tree, and he's looking out there, and then comes the angel of the Lord, and he jumps up, and he runs out to him. The terebinth tree represents strength. So he was sitting in a place of expectancy, because a doorway is you're about to go somewhere. You're either coming or you're going. And if he's sitting there facing out, then he's expecting something. So he's sitting in a place of expectancy, looking out, and the Lord shows up. Well, he gets the promise one more time, "You're going to have a child." Now, this is twice now that he had been given that promise that he's going to have a child. Okay, Lord, if Abraham is anything like me, he would be saying, "I got it. We're going to have a child. Just wondering when you might do that. You know, I've been kind of waiting here just a few years. And okay, nobody else, right? Everybody else in here has perfect faith. Y'all?" No. And so he says, so he believed it. He believed God. And then finally, after y'all know how many years? 20 years. He was able to have a son. Him and Sarah were able to have a son. And in Romans 4, I love Romans 4 because it says he hoped against hope. He had that anticipation. It's going to happen because God said it's going to happen. I don't have to make it happen. I don't have to manipulate it to happen. I don't have to stand on my head to make it happen. I just have to sit here underneath the terebinth tree, that tree of fatness, that tree of expectancy, and that tree of strength. And I have to wait on the Lord to pass by. And when the Lord passes by and says, "It's time," then it's time. And you will conceive. You will have that promise that God has given you, even though you've got to wait. And we could talk about David and how long he waited, and Noah. That's about 100 years Noah waited. Sometimes you got to wait a little bit once you've been given the promise. But don't let go. Don't let go. Hang on to that faith. One more man in Scripture I want to tell you about, because I like what the passage talks about with him, and that's Joshua. Now think about this. Cody, I thought about you when I was doing this. So, Joshua was like Moses's right hand. And, you know, but the thing is, he had walked with Moses. And so he knew the rebellious children of Israel. And, you know, he was on the mountain with Moses when he got the Ten Commandments and went down, and they had made a calf and was worshiping it. And he was there when they talked, when Korah and all of his group turned against Moses. Joshua saw all of this that happened to his mentor. He saw all of this, you know, and the negativity in the mouths of the people. And so then God, because he's got such a great sense of humor, decides to call Joshua then to be the leader of those people. And I just thought, you know what, I wonder if that was a quick, yes, Lord, here I am, or if it was like, wait, I'm not so sure. I know those people, and I know their rebellion, and I'm not so sure I want to lead them. But we're not told all the backside of the story, but nevertheless, he became the leader of the people. The Lord shows up and begins to talk to him. He's given him his little pep story, and his pep story goes like this. Three different times he told him, he said, I want you to be strong, and I want you to be courageous. I don't know about you, when the Lord gives me a word like that, I know something's coming. We're going to have a battle. But what that meant, when he told him to be strong, that meant that he had, that his legs were strong underneath him, that he had a good foundation underneath him. And when he said courageous, that's like the strength, your hand, you know, when you grasp something, like, you can either hold something really weak where it can fall out, or you can grasp onto it. And so that's what the Lord told him. And so I believe this is another word for somebody, but God wants you to stand strong in the word and the promise and in the faith that God's given you. Stand strong and don't let go. Amen. Don't let go. Now, whoever that is, whatever it is that you've been hanging on to, you don't let go. Keep a courageous grasp on whatever it is. And I'm going to give you a minute. I want you to write it down, because this for somebody, you're going to get it. You're going to get it. Keep the strong legs and the secure grasp. You're going to get what you've been asking for. Amen. And let me tell you, not because this old girl said so, because he said so. And what he says, it goes. And it doesn't matter what things look like. Amen. 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 So I like what George Mueller said. He said, if we desire our faith to be strengthened, we should not shrink from opportunities where our faith may be tried. It's because of that trial that I was strengthened. The more I'm in a position to be tried in faith, the more I have the opportunity of seeing God's help and deliverance. And every fresh instance in which he helps and delivers me will tend toward the increase of my faith. Thank you, Jesus, for allowing me to go through this, because on the other side of it, I'm going to have a testimony to your glory. I'll never forget, in a couple times, this happened three times. Mom and Dad, I've just seen it all my life, but when they hold hands, there's just something about the unity of prayer, but when they hold hands and they pray in agreement, I've seen some things happen. And not to manipulate God, not to control God. It's just they know God, and they know what God's capable of. And I'll never forget, there was a couple in our Sunday school class, and they had been trying for years to have a baby. And she was a school teacher, and he was a businessman. And they'd just given up that they were never going to have a child. And I said, you know, my parents prayed for a lady in their church that was barren and not able to have children. Not only that, but she had many miscarriages. And I said, would you mind? Because sometimes when people get to that point, they don't even want to talk about it. They don't even want you to pray with them anymore about it. You know, they're just so, like, burned from it. And I said, would you mind if I brought my parents over and we prayed just one more time for you and JR? And so Mom and Dad and I, they were living in Missouri, and I was in Tennessee. They drove over, and we got in a car, and we went to J.R. and Michelle's house. And so this tells you where my faith was. So we are standing in their kitchen, and we are praying, you know, and if you guys have been on a prayer meet with my parents, you know what I mean, when we were praying. And so we were praying. And about that time, my mother steps back like this, and I know when Mom's got it, you know, and the Lord spoke to her. She goes, Michelle, in 9 months, she said, I see children in this house. And I remember I was like, Mom, you know, because you don't prophesy about babies and I forget all that, whatever it is. You're not supposed to prophesy about. So it's a big no-no in prophecy, you know. And so I'm looking at Mom, but I know by the look on her face that, I think she heard from God. And so you know, it's just one of those things, let's wait and see, you know. And so sure enough, guys, I kid you not, within that month, she was pregnant. And they had, Lincoln is his name. They had Lincoln 9 months later. And I'm telling you, I've seen God. But they went through that, like, barren time, that dry time, that time where they just had to stand fast, you know, and hang on to what looked like hopelessness. And so whoever, whatever it is, if it's a child that you've been praying for, if it's a sickness or whatever it is, don't let go. Don't let go of that. Because he will answer you. He will answer you. Finally, let me read a quote here. It's actually a prayer, and I would like it to be my prayer, and perhaps you'd like to borrow it and let it be yours. It was A.W. Tozer. He said, "Oh God and Father, I repent." This is heavy. "I repent of my sinful preoccupation with visible things. The world has been too much with me. You have been here, and I didn't even know it. I have been blind to your presence. Open my eyes that I may behold you in and around me. Lord, forgive me where I have looked at circumstances to dictate if you're going to do it or not. Forgive me, Lord, where I've let the devil just have a little bit too much time entertaining my mind. Forgive me, Lord, where I've doubted for 1 minute what you promised me that you were going to do. And Lord, help me, like Abel, like Noah, like Enoch, help me just to be in your presence and enjoy that. I want to be more about you." In closing, Max Lucado gives you this promise. He said, it's in his book, Traveling Light. He said, "You have a God who hears you." I want somebody to get that. You have a God who hears you. He's not deaf. He doesn't go on vacation. He's not mad at you. He hears you. I really, really believe you got to get that in here. He hears me every time I utter my voice. He hears me. He knows my voice. My grandmother had, I can't remember how many grandkids, but every time I called her on the phone, she knew my name. She called me by name, and it surprised me. Not only that, she was able to recite every one of us and pray our names before the Lord. He knows you. He knows your name. He knows your heart. What you've been asking for, seeking for, looking for, desiring, he already knows it. He knows it. He knows it. So we have a God that hears. You have a God that hears you. The power of love is behind you. He loves you. The Holy Spirit is within you, and all of heaven is ahead of you. You have the shepherd. You have grace for every sin, direction for every turn, a candle for every corner, and an anchor for every storm. You have everything you need. Who can take it from you? Can leukemia infect your salvation? Can bankruptcy impoverish your prayers? Or tornado might take your earthly house, but will it touch your heavenly home? And look at your position. Why do you clamor for prestige and power? Are you not already privileged to be a part of the greatest work in history? Say this with me. The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. What a hope. What a confidence. And so tonight, in the midst of just junk, chaos, I just feel like the devil's doing this. And I think for just a few minutes here, if we can just say, quiet,
and let's let the Lord speak. Some of you, you already have the promise. You wrote it down. It's there. You got it. I believe, we'll step out on faith here. I believe, and I've said this, I just believe it. We're going to see miracles from this place. We're going to see healings from this place. Not because we're so wonderful and awesome. It's because He is. And because we're open. And our pastor's open. I don't know if you guys have noticed, but we have a worshiper for a pastor. He doesn't leave it up to Mary Helen and the worship team. He worships. He don't even look out here to see if you are. He's just going to worship. That's what we need to do, is have that heart of worship. And when we get in that place, it's like, Lord, I know You're going to do what You promised that You're going to do. And so I'm going to stand on that, and I'm not going to let go of that, irregardless of what the best lawyer in town says, irregardless of what the best doctor in town says. I trust them. I love them. I appreciate them. But they don't have the final say. And so, Lord, I'm going to hold on with strong legs and a firm grasp to what You've given me, and I'm going to see it. I'm going to see it. And we might just need a testimony service sometime after this. So I want a couple of prayer people to come up. Mary Helen, if y'all want to just a worship song. And I just want to kind of remind you at this point, the people that are up here, they just love the Lord, and they just happen to know what He's capable of, and they want to grab hold with you and have faith with you, to believe with you. Or it may be you've lost that faith. You know, sometimes it's just like, man, Lord, I don't even know where my faith is right now. And you just need someone to pray the prayer of faith for you and with you. So that's why they're up here. So the invitation is yours, that if either you've had a promise, you're holding on to it, and you just want someone to, hey, would you join in with me? I'm believing God for this. I want them to say, yes, me too. I'm going to believe God with you. And let's just pray in the Spirit and just see if He gives us something else on it. It may be that you haven't even tried to step out on faith yet on something, and you want them. Will you help me here? I'm not real sure how I should pray. But if you want prayer for anything, I want you to come up and grab somebody. I wouldn't miss it. I'm the type that I don't want to miss out on anything, and especially what God wants to give. And I really do think that God wants to blow some minds tonight. That God wants to do exceedingly above, more than you've ever asked or thought. And I believe that God wants to just wow you because of your faithfulness, because God's seen that faithfulness. And God has heard those prayers. God has seen those tears. And I just think that it'd be a good night, don't you? I think it'd be a good night for us to have some breakthroughs in this place, some healings in this place. So they're going to sing.